This video is sponsored by Skillshare. These two 3D printer nozzles look basically the same from the outside, yet one of them features a super sophisticated internal structure that splits up the filament and significantly increases the surface area to melt the plastic way more efficiently. This is finally E3D's brand new Revo high flow nozzle. But how good is it really, and how does its performance compare to Bondtech's CHT nozzle that I installed using a custom adapter into my Voron 3D printer? Let's find out more. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. High-flow 3D printer nozzles are, in my opinion, one of the most important additions to 3D printing of the last years because they're able to melt more material way more quickly at the same size as a standard nozzle. No more long, unstable hot ends and custom fan shrouds. E3D released their Revo hot end system over a year ago, which is great if you swap nozzles regularly, yet it uses custom and design patented nozzles, so you were only able to use their nozzles. And this was a serious problem and the reason why I replaced the Revo hot end on my LDO Voron 2.4 with a Fades Rapido at some point. In the beginning, E3D only sold brass nozzles for Revo, so I wasn't able to work with abrasive filaments and they didn't offer any high flow options. Their abrasion-resistant obsidian nozzle finally started shipping some weeks ago, and we now also have Revo High Flow, where E3D teamed up with Bondtech to bring the core heating technology to Revo. Links to both are in the description if you want to pick one up. When I saw the first images of the internals of the nozzle, I was really intrigued because it looked even more fancy than Bondtech's CHT design. The only way you're able to spot if you have a Revo high flow is of course the marking, but technically more important, this small line that you're seeing at the bottom of the nozzle. The fancy internal structure is not metal 3D printed, but the high flow portion got press fit into the nozzle body, and this brass lug with the teardrop dome and the four bores that go to the tip make all of the difference. The amount of material that you can melt in a 3D printer hotend is in most cases not limited by the amount of heating power that your hotend has. Polymers are quite a bad conductor of heat, so even though your nozzle is super hot, it takes a while until the heat traveled into the inside of the filament to properly melt everything. In the past, high flow hotends were just longer with the well-known volcano hotends, so the filament stays longer in the melt zone. In E3D's high flow design, the filament gets expanded over the dome structure, and this has a bunch of benefits. First, the material section gets thinner, from my reverse engineering to around 1 mm from the initial 1.75 mm, so it takes less time for the heat to travel to the inside. And since the inner dome is connected to the rest of the nozzle, it now also heats the material from the inside, hence Bondtech's or rather 3D Solex's core heating technology. After the dome section, the molten material gets channeled back into the nozzle tip before it leaves the small orifice. This sophisticated internal structure results in almost double the surface area that touches the plastic and over 60% more time for the filaments to pass and also melt in the nozzle. I know this sounds like a sales pitch, but at a price of around $45 to $50 each, it definitely needs one. And we'll test if it holds up to its claims in a second. Yet, do you know who doesn't need a sales pitch? Skillshare, who sponsored today's video. And you shouldn't skip forward because I'm sharing how Skillshare seriously helped me to come from the stupid idea of posting my first video to where I'm at today with my own film studio and a product business. We all have our individual talents, things we are naturally good at and better than many others. I, for example, was always good at working on science projects. Still, in order to create a content creation business out of that, I lacked the skill of video editing, filming, and something that many overlook in the beginning, the skill of organizing myself and even how to run a business in the first place. And this is why I always came back to Skillshare over the years, because it's the best way to learn creative skills for personal and professional goals. And if you don't believe me, then just sign up for their 1 month free trial using the link below. You all know Skillshare for their classes on photography, filmmaking, and video editing, where you can learn from the best of the industry. Skillshare can also finally teach you CAD with Fusion 360 tutorials starting at beginner level, and you can even get a jumpstart in 3D printing. Yet the most important thing for me right now is transitioning from a one-man show to a team where organization and productivity becomes essential. So I'm learning from the best again and taking a class on the organization tool Notion taught by the king of productivity itself, Ali Abdaal. If you also want to unlock a new career or just learn a new creative skill, then join Skillshare using the link below. And if you are under the first 1000 to click it, you will also get a 1 month free trial. And now back to E3D's new Revo high flow nozzle. Let's try it out and see how well it performs. I of course wanted to compare it to Bondtech's CHT nozzle, but since you can screw a standard nozzle into a Revo, I had to use a trick. By coincidence, a viewer from Mexico named Matias sent me a prototype of his Revo 2 V6 adapter that he recently launched on Indiegogo. This is not an endorsement of this product because I had my fair share of leaking and installation problems with it, but I tried to give Matias some feedback and advice to improve the retail version, and maybe someone of you might be interested as well. I did all of my tests on the LDO Voron 2.4 using the Clockwork 2 extruder and some voxel PLA at 220 degrees nozzle temperature. Currently, I only have the 0.4 mm version of the Revo High Flow, so this was what I tested and compared to a regular Revo and Bondtech CHT. The flow test is quite simple, and I extrude this meandering structure at higher and higher speeds until we can see extrusion problems. I started at 5 cubic millimeters a second, which is around 50 millimeters a second printing speed at 0.2 millimeter layers, and increased the extrusion rate by 1 cubic millimeters a second every millimeter of print height. Our reference, the normal Revo nozzle, started misbehaving at 14 cubic millimeters a second, which would be around 150 millimeters a second printing speed, where you can already see that not everyone needs a high flow nozzle. You can always check the flow rates of your prints in your slicer preview, by the way. The failure mode is really interesting because we can see these bulge corners, which is a sign of insufficiently molten material that's more like rubber when it leaves the nozzle and then contracts again, leaving you with this kind of a phenomenon. Let's now check how well Bondtech CHT perform. I installed it in Matthias' V6 adapter, but it had a ton of material leak at first, because with this sample he tries to seal it at the hex and not at the bottom, which is in my opinion a very bad idea, and I hope that he's going to fix that. Don't tell anyone, but I used some Teflon tape to seal it, which did the trick. This setup has the advantage that the melt zone is longer because it sticks out, yet on the other hand it's not properly insulated, which might reduce extrusion temperatures. I temporarily insulated it with some Kapton tape, but still take these results with a pinch of salt. The CHT performed 60% better than the stock Revo, with a maximum flow rate of 22 cubic millimeters a second, where the extruder motor started skipping, which resulted in holes in the outer wall. So let's test the fancy E3D Revo High Flow. It performed the best and increased the flow rate capability by almost 70% compared to the reference, achieving 23.5 cubic millimeters a second, which would be 260 millimeters per second printing speed at 0.2 millimeter layers, and therefore even beating the CHT. This shows that the complex internal structure even improved Bondtech's already ingenious design, yet with a definitely higher manufacturing effort. According to E3D's blog, the bigger size nozzles should perform even better, yet since I don't have any, I can't confirm this myself. I also did my Blobb and poop test, which tells us even a bit more about a nozzle's performance. The results were pretty similar, with a maximum flow rate of 16 cubic millimeters a second for normal Revo, 22 cubic millimeters a second with a Bondtech CHT on an adapter, and finally 24 cubic millimeters a second for the new Revo High Flow. This test also showed how consistently E3D's new high flow nozzle works in a very wide flow range, because it only really drops off once it reaches its maximum extrusion rate. If this has an impact on print quality is something we'll take a look at as well, but before that I also have to talk about E3D's new 60 watt heater core. If you buy a regular Revo, it comes by default with a 40 watt heating element, which is sufficient for all of the standard flow nozzles. The 60 watt version is another roughly $50 accessory, but do you really need it? Well, I did all of my tests with a 40 watt unit, because I'm certain that it has enough power for even high speed printing with a 0.4 millimeter nozzle. And here is the proof. Mainsail, the interface that I use for Clipper on my Voron 2.4, can show you the duty cycle of your heater. Hot end heaters are usually PWM controlled, which means that they are turned on and off again in very quick succession to adjust the power output. The ratio between on time and off time is the duty cycle. And this info is displayed in Mainsail, which shows some really interesting data. I wrote down the maximum duty cycle during the extrusion test, and with a normal Revo, it used 63% heating power at 14 cubic millimeters a second. With a CHT, it used 73% heating power at 22 cubic millimeters a second. And with the Revo High Flow, the heater was on 71% of the time at 25 cubic millimeters a second flow rate. So even at maximum flow, we only used 3/4 or 30 watts of the available 40 watts of heating power. But wait, why are we only using 13% more heating power at a flow rate that is 80% higher? Well observed! So the power that you put into your hot end is not only used to melt the plastic, some of it also just dissipates away. There are several different paths where your heat goes on a hot end besides melting the plastic. First, there is heat conduction through the heat break. Then there is natural convection and radiation of the heater block itself. Once you turn on part cooling, you'll additionally have forced convection because some air actively flows over the nozzle and the heater block. So to get an idea of how much energy simply dissipates away without melting anything, I did some stationary tests. I increased the hot end temperature in steps with part cooling on and off, and very interestingly also with and without the silicone sock. So in the optimal setup without part cooling and the sock on the hot end, it used 19% heating power at 180 degrees Celsius and 39% power at 290 degrees Celsius. With the sock removed, it only needed slightly more power. It becomes more interesting when we turn part cooling on, because then we already require 33% heating power at 180 degrees Celsius and a whopping 65% heating power at 290 degrees Celsius to only hold the temperature without any material that gets molten. Removing the sock also has a huge impact because it increases the energy consumption to 41% at 180 degrees Celsius and 82% at 290 degrees Celsius, which leaves almost no more headroom for melting plastic, so make sure to not lose your socks. If we combine these numbers with the extrusion test, we can calculate that we need roughly 1% of heating power or half a watt per cubic millimeters a second extrusion rate. This is a good value to keep in mind. This, for example, means that your heater only uses 5 watts of its power at an already decently fast 10 cubic millimeters a second flow rate for melting plastic. The rest gets dissipated as heat. And I, of course, performed some flow tests, where the difference between the two heaters for the 0.4mm nozzle was negligible. All of these numbers show that if you primarily plan to use a 0.4mm Revo high flow nozzle, you don't need a 60 watt heater core, and even with the 0.6mm nozzle, most won't really need it. Only at bigger diameters and printing high temperature materials, the 60 watt heater core will become interesting and necessary. If you get a completely new Revo, you can opt for the high power heater core because it makes the nozzle heat up even more quickly and gives you a bit more headroom in difficult situations. Since I have one, the 60 watt heater core will be my new daily driver on Revo. So we have seen that E3D's new high flow nozzle significantly increases the flow capabilities of the Revo ecosystem. But is it a drop-in replacement or does it result in worse print quality if you print slowly? The answer is pretty simple. I printed some parts in PLA with the standard and the high flow Revo, and the results were basically indistinguishable. Surfaces looked the same, stringing was the same, and overhangs looked very similar. So at least for this material, it doesn't really matter, and I see no reason why you shouldn't use E3D's new Revo HF as a replacement. Yet I didn't test all materials and know of reports that people had problems with Bondtech CHT and some materials like TPU. So do some research before you buy a high flow nozzle for a non-standard application. In the end, does this mean that you should get Revo High Flow right away? If you already have a Revo hot end installed on your machine and want or need to print faster, this is finally the option we've all been waiting for. From the tests I've done, it at least performs as well as Bondtech's CHT nozzle and delivers more melting power in the same package size. If you mainly print with 0.4mm nozzles, you should ask yourself if you really need it, because the nozzle only becomes the bottleneck if you're going over 150mm a second printing speed. If you often print with 0.6mm and bigger, the Revo High Flow quickly makes sense, and at some point you'll also have to upgrade the heater core to the 60 watt version. On the downside, these new multi-part nozzles are quite expensive at $45 and something you should think about twice when buying. And then there's the abrasion resistant problem all over again, because high flow is currently only available in brass and therefore not suitable for any abrasive filaments. And talking about particles, one of the things where I'm a bit concerned about is how easily you can clean this nozzle when it's clogged. Cold pulling is straightforward on a regular nozzle, and with some practice also doable on Bondtech CHT. Yet, so far, I was only able to cold pull Revo High Flow once, and I'd call myself quite skilled in cold pulling. E3D also says it's possible, but be prepared for some headaches when you get something stuck in your precious nozzle. If you regularly switch nozzles, and honestly, I do this way more often since I got Revo, the Revo ecosystem is now finally complete and I can recommend it for most applications if you are not on a budget. Yet if you're looking for the best performing hotend purely in terms of flow rate, the Revo High Flow isn't the one that you should get because it's still limited by the length of the melt zone. A Rapido High Flow or even Ultra High Flow, for example, has a significantly longer melt zone, and if you additionally install a Bondtech CHT in there, it will outperform Revo. Links to other high flow hotends as well as the new Revo high flow nozzle are down in the description. That helped me pay the bills right here. But what are your thoughts on E3D's CHT? Would you have expected that they team up with Bondtech, and would you spend almost 50 bucks on a brass nozzle just for more speed?
Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you found this video interesting. If you want to support my work, head over to Patreon or become a YouTube member. Also, check out the other videos in my library. I hope to see you in the next one. Auf Wiedersehen and goodbye.
Let's start with recording some audio. This video is sponsored by Skillshare.